do a little bit on this other one. The section of hydric soil here that the driveway will be crossing, and as the plan stands now, we're also proposing a driveway to serve a lot up here, which would be Joe Fastacci's own house lot. And that also crosses a section of hydric soil. Most of the, all the items on the list have been submitted in some way or another. A few of the items were deemed partially complete. And rather than go over them one at a time, I think you might want to ask some questions about those. We do, several of them apply to a discrepancy we have about which soils are considered hydric. I know Maureen and Ernie, the code enforcement officer, have both pointed out that in the Caples, the town ordinance, it does specify that Naskeg and Naumburg soils are considered hydric, and we disagree with that, and I have Al Frick that will address that issue. We also wanted to talk about, Maureen had suggested that we might want to look at using one long driveway instead of these two driveways as we've shown here. We wondered if we could get some comments from the board on how they felt about that before we proceeded. And we'd also like to leave here with a date for a site walk. I'd like to let Al Frick address that one issue that I feel is the biggest issue on the list here.
Thank you. That's the wetlands and the hydric soils.
The hydric soils, right.
Okay. This is Mr. Frick.
Yes, my name is Albert Frick. I'm a certified soil scientist and site evaluator who worked on this project along with Jim Logan. I'd like to make one clarification to what Courtney said, that we do not dispute totally that Naumburg and Naskeg soils are non-hydric. What we're... Naskeg and Naumburg soils are mapped by the Soil Conservation Service as dual drainage soils. They include both somewhat poorly drained and poorly drained. Let's present this to the board to the chair. It's a description of the Soil Conservation Service mapping units for Naumburg and Naskeg, which is the point.
Okay, why don't you just leave them here and we'll distribute them from here. Thank you.
The issue is, as you know, the zoning ordinance, chapter 19.1.3, defines hydric soils and declares that very poorly drained and poorly drained soil are deemed to be hydric. And Naskeg and Naumburg, portions of Naskeg and Naumburg fit that definition. The portions that are poorly drained would be hydric soils. There's also portions of Naskeg and Naumburg that are somewhat poorly drained. And that means that by your definition, you need to have standing water at the surface of the ground for 21 consecutive days during the growing season, which is defined from May 1st through October 1st. And in the Naskeg somewhat poorly drained soil and the Naumburg somewhat poorly drained soil, those conditions would not be met, which would not deem it to be a hydric soil. When we did the mapping, knowing what issues and criteria the Cape Elizabeth Board has before them, we delineated the two conditions of the Naumburg, those that are going to be hydric or wetland soils and those which are going to be non-hydric or wetlands. We did the same for Naskeg, and that's why we feel that the delineations are accurate in accordance with the criteria that the board is charged to review it with. Be glad to expand upon that or answer any questions.
I'm going to ask our planner to explain something, if not to me, then to perhaps the rest of the viewing audience, why this particular item is so crucial here. why it being mapped either one or the other makes a particular difference.
Well, the subdivision ordinance requires that you indicate the different zones on the plan. For the resource protection or the wetland protection zones, those zones are dictated by soils and plant conditions rather than dimensions from roadways or from parcels. So if you have a poorly drained soil, it is supposed to be considered a wetland protection zone. And the ordinance has defined that a poorly drained soil will include a certain list of soils. The Naskag and Nomberg soils are in that list. So if you find a Naskag or a Nomberg soil on your property, it's considered to be a wetland protection zone. And that's the whole issue here. If you're in a wetland protection zone, you're restricted in the type of activities you're allowed to conduct. And there are several other activities which you are permitted to do if you get a special permit from the planning board. But to get that special permit, you need to submit special information. So if there are areas that have Naskag or Nomberg soils, the type of activities that are allowed in there and whether or not you need a permit are important, and whether or not that area is a wetland protection zone governs the whole rest of the regulation and the type of review that the board is supposed to do in that area.
Thank you, Maureen.
Judy Larkin? I'd just like to ask a question on that, not knowing that part of the ordinance particularly well. There is a listing of soils that meet certain criteria. Does the criteria, what Mr. Frick is saying is that we have certain criteria, and by those criteria, these portions of those soil groups do not meet wetland standards. Is there something in the standard that would rule out those portions of the soils, even though they are included on the list?
The definition under hydric soils, which is in the zoning ordinance, says soils defined in the U.S. Soil Conservation Service publication entitled Hydric Soils of Southern Maine, or is further revised. These soils shall include, but shall not be limited to, the following. And it lists as, under number 3, poorly drained mineral soils, including Atherton, Arley, Brayton, Charles, Easton, Frieden, Lyme, Monardo, Musilaki, Naskag, Nomberg, Roundabout, Rumney, Skantic, and so on. It did pursue some of that. No soil is exactly like any other soil, mm-hmm. And I did talk to the code enforcement officer who's vested with authority for interpreting this ordinance, and his feeling is that when the wetland protection zone was defined and included the poorly drained soils, it was supposed to include transitional soils.
And this is all we have to go by to define what is...
Well, there are other sections in the ordinance that this kind of builds on it. There's a section that talks about hydric soils, and there's a section that defines what the wetland protection zone is, and it talks about wetland soils that are poorly drained or otherwise have wetland characteristics. But this seems to be fairly explicit.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chair.
Mr.
Frick, basically what you're saying is that you don't think they should be, that our ordinance should include transitional soils,
right?
In that classification.
What I mean to say is 3 points. Number one, the Soil Conservation Service, along with the Army Corps of Engineers and the DEP, do not consider somewhat poorly drained soils as hydric soils. So going into your definition of hydric soils, it starts off as a definition, soils as defined in U.S. Soil Conservation Service publication entitled Hydric Soils of Southern Maine. It sets the conditions for very poorly drained and poorly drained, which your definition does address, but then goes on to include, lists some but not all poorly and very poorly drained recognized in the state of Maine. And I think the first point that's listed on your definition, very poorly drained and poorly drained, is the criteria that's important for a definition of hydric soils, not the fact that it's Naskag or Nomberg, because portions of those two units cannot meet the criteria of a hydric soil. This is also supported in the wetlands ordinance and other portions in your zoning ordinance, which goes on to talk about hydric soils, which that the substrate is saturated with water to the surface or submerged for at least 20 consecutive days during the growing season.
I understand what you're going through,
and I get the case.
Don't mean to interrupt you, but I think the point is here, for me anyway, I do understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to keep this to the completeness issue, you make it more difficult for me as one board member to just say, well, we don't agree with the ordinance, so we'll change what we have on our site plan to limit it to these areas. It would be much easier for me if you were to go by the ordinance and let us deal with those transitional soils in those areas.
I believe we did go by the ordinance by delineating. I read the ordinance to imply that you want to cull out, delineate very poorly drained soils, which you defined as critical wetlands, and you want to delineate poorly drained soil, which you defined as wetland protection zone.
I guess going back to the completeness issue again, where it comes into play, of course, is in the driveway detail and how that should be treated in different soils areas.
The planting issue is going to be the extent of the filling, which I don't think is a big difference. And I think it's more of an academic debate than perhaps a big, substantial planting issue. But I do feel that the soils work was complete in accordance with the criteria of which to develop.
I guess I wouldn't agree with that, but I mean, it is a relatively minor, it's not substantive. It would be easier for me as one board member to interpret if you just said, yes, we don't agree, but your ordinance says to do this.
But we did show all the Naumburg and Nascay. We went one step further to delineate poorly and somewhat poorly.
Okay.
And it's a judgment call. Thank you.
Okay, Ms. Jones again?
Yeah, well, I just want to say that it is all tied into the completeness issue, because four or five of these items, which are labeled partial, are because we have cross-hatched what we are calling hydric, and so far we haven't come to agreement on if we should be cross-hatching, you know, that would include this is somewhat poorly drained. I guess that's what the difference is on completeness aspect of this application.
I guess the only issue for me is if you cross-hatch all of that area that by ordinance we deem should be treated that way, it's a very awesome amount of area, and I'm just saying, well, just leave it there and let us deal with that. We understand what that area is. It also gives us guidance as how the different locations in that site should be treated. I'll leave it up to the consensus of the rest of the board how they would like to see it done.
Okay. May I ask through the planner, is the question on the labeling a question of what's cross-hatched or what's labeled?
A question of what is cross-hatched. As I stated, the applicant is supposed to show on the plans those areas, the zoning for the site.
Mm-hmm.
And if a Nascaig and a Naumburg is considered to be a poorly drained soil, as our ordinance requires that to be, then it must be considered a wetland protection zone.
So it's a matter of his labeling a particular soil the way we interpret it, because the soils are all labeled. It's perfectly, we can read them. In addition, only
it kind of is a domino thing, because after you identify all the areas that are wetland protection zones, when you move into the wetland special permit process, all areas where you're altering a wetland require special information. So if you haven't identified all the areas that supposedly are wetland protection zones, then there is some information you're not getting. For example, alteration in a wetland area requires a 1 foot contour, whereas alteration in a non-wetland area, you don't need that 1 foot contour. alteration in a wetland area, you need to know cubic, you need to know a lot more about the fill and the alteration, whereas on the existing plan before you, there are some areas where the driveway will run, or and most of Lot 4, where if you consider those areas to be wetland protection zones, you may want to request additional information in order to do your wetland special permit review. If that isn't a wetland protection zone, then you don't need that information because you don't have to issue a wetlands permit for that area.
Thank you. Do you have anything additional before we...
No, you can go ahead and fire away.
Do I have some comments from the board?
Yes, I would like to ask Ms. if she would. I have before me the a memo of March the 17th from the town planner, but then also an application completeness checklist, both for the minor subdivision and for the wetlands alteration. And if you have those same documents, I think, frankly, the easiest way for me to move through these would be just for you to address the issues that have already been brought up and tell us what your position is on them.
Okay, let's go. Start with number one.
Mm-hmm.
On the application completeness checklist, I'll just go to the ones that have partial.
Mm-hmm.
Leave the ones that are all complete.
Yes.
To themselves. Okay, the first one, the project name was not put on, the soil plan you have doesn't show the project name. It is on the original soil plan now, but I just didn't want to make 21 new copies because that was the only thing that changed on that plan. For the final submission, that you'll have that new plan with the only change being the title. Okay, number 4A. The next two, 4A and 10, both fall into the category we're just talking about. We feel that the map does show the crosshatched areas as defined in the ordinance. That's something we want an answer from the board on tonight, whether you agree with us that we are going by the ordinance in this case. Okay. Number 11B, I think that was in reference to Portland Water District for the town engineer. Okay, the town engineer wanted a proposed joint water service established. That we did submit the where the water lines were going to be on the plan, and we have a letter from Portland Water District of the capacity in that area. And this is an additional item that, yeah, I just got this memo yesterday myself. So that is why that's a partial thing. That's a comment that came back to us that will be no problem. That's just something I think would be part of the deeds, actually, per lot when they share a driveway and they'll have shared utilities. This was a suggestion by the Portland Water District that they have a joint water line. Number 12, we have completed and submitted a stormwater management plan from professional engineer Steve Oberge, and I think it may be deemed partial because of the comments of the town engineering firm, T.Y. Lynn, has sent us back some comments with some questions and some comments on revisions we might do. Most of those are no problem. Most of the things they did agree with. So again, that was something that was submitted. It's just that they had some additions that we might consider for that.
And do you have any objection to submitting, in particular, the erosion control measures?
No, I think it was just they were suggesting some additional erosion control measures. And I talked to the engineer this morning. He said he has no problem with basically any of this. It's all kind of working plans. That's how it goes. You have a back and forth, and that's when you make revisions. It's not something we could have done ahead of time. He could read their minds. The number 13, the technical statement was, well, these were both submitted, and Maureen's comment is that the financial one was vague, and I guess we could work on that.
Could I ask, interrupt right here? There were two pieces of information relative to financial capacity. One was sort of a resume of some subdivisions he'd done, and another was a statement of a bank account. Was the partial reference to both of those items, or to one of them, or even with both of them, are they still great?
When I put these lists together, I try to, for the board's effort, pick out everything that I can see that might be missing, and then it's up to you to decide whether that is a substantial incomplete item or not. In this case, I was referring to the financial capability. The board may find that is sufficient. It just seemed that in the past the board had gotten more in terms of the applicant demonstrating financial capability. In terms of demonstrating technical capability, usually what the board receives is a resume of projects that the applicant has completed in the past, and that's what the applicant submitted.
I, for one, only got the sheet that has technical capacity on it and did not get anything about a bank account. Am I just missing a piece of paper, or?
You didn't dig hard and deep enough. That's all. Buried. Listed in the letters at the back.
Mm-hmm.
After the city of South Portland. Last letter.
Okay. Is it in this package? February 27th? Yeah. It is.
February 27th?
Yeah.
While everybody's looking, I'll ask a question on the technical capability. Was the applicant on the first subdivision referred to, not the Glenwood Farms in South Portland, but the other? Were you, Mr. Forsyth, the applicant when that was approved? Or were you the builder in that subdivision?
On the Glenwood Farms subdivision?
No, the other one.
The first one, the FGI group in Marlboro Road in Portland?
Yeah, I guess I don't have it in front of me. You only listed two different parties. The second
one,
you weren't really
Portland.
The developer, you were the builder.
One was in Portland, and I was a partner in that venture. The FGI group was the applicant, and I was a member of that.
Were you the applicant for the approval of the subdivision itself?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, I think
the Glenwood Farms subdivision, I was not the applicant for the planning board. I was the eventual builder in there. And
I'm familiar
not,
with that one.
Okay.
Are there other subdivisions you were actually the developer of, other than the builder? Other than these,
the
that one?
No, the one at the Marlboro Ray Gardens was the only one. I might also mention, while we're on the financial capability and the technical capability, these were asking for basically four lots that are close to public facilities, road, water and sewer, and this one up here. And I'm not looking for major improvements such as roads and extending sewer lines. We are asking for an extension of a water line here, and basically we're looking for private utilities coming from the town accepted road. So basically I'm looking for four house lots without the major infrastructure improvements. And when we do the site walk, I can probably explain it in better detail.
Thank you. Is it Janet who was? Were you the one going down the list? Was
mm-hmm.
it? Do you want to?
I'm going down the list.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know, did you find the?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So then we're on to number 14.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and what's, so we want, the question is whether it's going to be overhead or underground, and Joe did talk to CMP about that, and it's not shown on the plans. It's something that we'll show on the plans for the next meeting, and I think we decided it will be overhead up the driveway and then underground to each individual house in this case. Number 15 is copies of any covenants or deed restrictions, and this is partial again because we have submitted deeds, sample deeds, but they're not specific as to as legal, the legal jargon. These are written up by the surveyor describing exactly where they are and what they're serving. Okay. Number 17B is a no, and I guess, is that something that the board usually gets? It's not something I'm responsible for here. Written evidence from the town manager and town attorney. That's something that probably happens later on in the
Madam
process.
Chair?
Yes.
I think, doesn't that reference to the pedestrian easement? Is that what that's referring to? And that was extremely unclear to me whether the on the plan that we have, whether the pedestrian easement is supposed to be the curved line that you indicate from the road to the wetlands area?
Well, there is a written description of the what are we calling it?
I think what we had asked for is that
that is described, this very specific area of that is described. We have covenants from, we do have the legal covenants for that particular easement from Joe's lawyer on what activities can take place in that easement. And there is also a surveyor's written description of exactly what area we're talking about. Is that what you're
Was that on the plan that you submitted?
It was an attachment. The written part was an attachment, and it is shown on the plan. You might be confused. I did try and delineate it. There is lines on the plan showing the easement area, yes.
I saw the reference.
Right, all around. Yeah.
Okay. Could you show us where that is again, please? The pedestrian easement.
I think it's behind this dotted line. It's just unclear.
Let her explain it.
Okay, starting here, so this dashed line, then along the edge of the pond, and then back down to here.
So there's no other through access through the lot. It's just a corner of the lot that's been dedicated.
Right.
There's no line here. It doesn't show that it goes down the pond, but I guess legally it's described.
I missed it.
Okay. Do you want to talk about, should I just go to the next list, the wetlands alteration permit list? Is that okay with everybody? Yes. Okay, the first one, detailed site plan, is a partial. I'm not sure exactly what the specifics are. Maureen might know something. There might be something specific that's not detailed there. I'm not sure.
Can you answer that, Maureen?
I just referenced to the town engineer's comments. He asked for some specific additional information.
Then that all ties back into what I talked about on that last list.
Mm-hmm.
B is, the existing grades. Here we did ask for a waiver to just show 1 foot, to leave it as 2 foot contours instead of 1 foot contours through the wetland soils, because we did submit detailed profiles and thought that would be enough detail that you wouldn't actually need us to go out and map the 1 foot contours. I'm not sure how much more information that would show. The engineer felt that it wouldn't make much difference since he is showing the exact profile cross section of those crossings. Okay. Down to E, that's another one. We were asking for a waiver because of the detail of the soil map. We didn't feel that we needed to do this additional study. If you have a question about that, Alfred has addressed that in a memo from him, and you can also talk to him about that one, but I'll just finish this list while I'm here. F, okay, that's just the same thing again. That's back to which ones are hydric and which ones aren't, which is back to that first argument. So I feel that this is basically complete as a very complete application. The few things that were partial had to do with this question that we haven't quite resolved yet, and some of the stormwater issues, which were basically just comments from the town engineer to our engineer, which will be worked out by the next meeting, which was nothing major there. So you can just go ahead and deem us complete then.
We have more comments from the board now. Janet McKay, you're ready to talk?
Yes, I have. I'll say this, that the two things which concern me are the two things that concern me most, I would say, are the issue of the soils map and then the issue of the demonstrated financial capability. And if I understand the soils issue, what I understand is that the ordinance itself has very specific language and that includes both Nauspegen and Naumburg, that the code enforcement officer, who has been designated as the interpreter at first instance of this ordinance, has an inclusive reading of the statute. And if I were inclined to take a position opposite or adverse to the court enforcement officer, I don't know that you've given me much to work with in the sense of supporting that. I guess based on what the information is that I have now, I would pretty much have to come to the conclusion that in the absence of demonstrated even if the ordinance were just absolute dead wrong, I don't think that we would have the power to change it, that there would have to be some way of going back to the ordinance committee and saying, this is just a mistake, and we certainly see it as a mistake in this particular project, and here's why we need quick action to try to reverse it. That's the most serious issue to me. The second issue with respect to financial capability has to do with the public's concern, obviously, that the project not be started and then aborted halfway through or some partial way through. And I appreciate that no one likes to share financial information any more than they have to. But simply to advise of what a particular bank account balance is doesn't help me very much if I don't know what the offsetting liabilities are. So I would, I'd certainly stand to be educated with respect to what we quote-unquote normally get for financial capability, but I'm not convinced, at least in the first instance, that I have seen sufficient here.
I think in light of Judy Lardner's earlier comments, I guess if I were an applicant for a four lot subdivision, and with due respect to the town's ordinance, if I came in with a soils map like this and Al Frick on my arm, I'd be hard pressed not to see that I had a complete application. What I feel we have here is a difference of opinion. And I would deem the application complete, and then if we have a difference of opinion, it needs to be settled as to the delineation of those wetlands and the applicant understanding that they're susceptible to changes in the plan because of perhaps a delineation wetland that doesn't agree with what they've delineated. As long as everyone understands that, I don't have any problem tonight deeming this as being complete. From the soil standpoint, I feel quite comfortable with what I see here. And I would say, in light of the engineer's comments, I also feel that for a minor subdivision, I don't see anything that's insurmountable I think some of the issues that the engineer brings up have to be addressed in tandem with the issue of the delineation of the wetlands and the subsequent zones or districts that those would fall out into.
Thank you. Is there some other comment?
Madam Chair.
Mr.
I don't disagree with Ms. Emery. But I do think that our ordinance, like Mrs. McKay says, right or wrong, that's our guideline. I look at it differently than Tom, and that I just think it was a bad decision by the applicant to strong showing of a nice soils map and a renowned soil scientist or not. She simply didn't do what we asked by the ordinance to do. I don't find it difficult to deal with a larger area that's crosshatched. And I understand it is only a four-lot subdivision. I have a real problem starting or setting a precedent where we continuously waver from what our ordinance tells us to do.
Thank you. Judy Lardner?
I'd like to comment on that same line. I believe the requirement, and Maureen can correct me, is that the zones be delineated. That's what's in question here. And they're saying the zones are delineated, and we're saying they're wrong. First off, I don't think that's a completeness issue. Even if you want to get into whether it's completeness or not or substantive, given what our ordinance says, you know, which is so apparently black and white, I would still want an attorney's opinion, because if I were reading that definition, they say very poorly drained, just because it doesn't say somewhat poorly drained beyond that, I'm not convinced that those same soils wouldn't again be listed, because often Mr. Frick knows much better than I do, but I think groups of soils often have very different characteristics depending on whether they're found on a slope or not. So I'm not convinced including that on the list means that's the only place it would be. I mean, I'm not going to pass substantive judgment, but his rationale, I think, requires even a legal opinion on this and not just a scientist's point of view. And I don't think our ordinance is as clear as some of the board members might think on that matter.
I'd like to ask, Ms. Lardner, you mentioned you didn't see it as a completeness issue. Can you just expand on that, why I'd be convinced not to consider it that?
Well, when I used to review plans, the way we looked at it was an application is complete. Well, is it complete and is it adequate? And if they show me the zoning boundaries, I mean, let's say it's not even to do with the resource protection, which is very nebulous. It's not on the face of the earth. It's defined in the ordinance, and someone has to plot it. If they show the RA zone between two lots and it was incorrect, it should have been a lot over, I'd say that's complete. They're wrong. It's not adequate. They've got to change it. But they've shown the ordinance. And the reason why I take this position is because completeness, when you get down to lawsuits and so forth, where it gives applicants standing, I think it's a very important issue. Where you might think I'm kind of pushing things through tonight, saying they're complete when other people disagree. And the converse, I'm absolutely opposed to these conditional approvals we've given, where you say it's complete if you give us these other things. So it's one of my bugaboos. Something is complete or it's not, and it's pretty black or white to me. And obviously we have different interpretations.
Further comment? I would ask no, I'm not going to. I'm just going to go on and say that I agree with much what Judy said. It's there. I mean, I can put the crosshatches on that if it makes me happier. But it's a complete soils map, and whether that at least with respect to the soils, I feel that it's complete. The issue for me would be, what are we going to do in those soils? And that might be where we would where I would find more. We say it's just, but it's not really that. Is there? Do we have other feelings from the board with respect to that?
I just see, for instance, under the town planner's comments on page 2, other issues. Some of those issues get into substantive review. If a driveway is going through a wetland, and we have an issue of where that wetland is, I feel we have to get to substantive review to get into those issues. And I would favor finding it substantially complete. The items that the engineer has raised are here. I don't see, putting a geotextile under riprap until 5 years ago wasn't even available, 10 years ago wasn't available technologically from a technical standpoint. So I don't see that as a substantive issue. The riprap is indicated, and it's just amending a detail for a final review. So I feel quite comfortable approving this as a complete application.
Judy Larder. I'd like to answer a little further Mr. Etzel's question, if I could, because I don't think my choice of terms was very good. When I was talking about complete versus adequate, I was talking about complete in terms of an overall application, meaning you have a list saying you shall submit a soils report, you shall submit a map showing delineation of the zone boundaries. As long as, for instance, if they didn't hire Al Frick and they photocopied a few pages from the county Cumberland County soils report and did a write-up, I think we'd all know that's inadequate. In my mind, though, that would have been a soils report, and showing boundaries of zones, whether they're accurate or not, is addressing that. I did not mean that it's a complete soils report or a complete depiction of zone boundaries in the sense of being accurate. Mm-hmm. I was not using that word that way.
I don't disagree with you. And I'm trying to think, maybe I'm letting myself be swayed too much by experience of how difficult the adequacy, the lack of adequacy may be in handling this site or this minor subdivision application in the process, that we backtrack. No, not all the hydric soils have been identified as wetlands zones. We get into that 2 months from now, 3 months from now. We backtrack to today. Why didn't we do that? The applicant gets upset with us because we send them back one more time, because then we want to have more information. I'm just not, I guess I'm letting that determine my opinion too much. Because I think your point is well taken, I really do.
Do we have any other discussion?
It's been an interesting discussion tonight about completeness, and I think I've learned something. I guess what I hope I've learned something. What the question that I have is, if we determine tonight that the application is complete based on the soils information that we have before us, does that in any way impact us in requiring further soils information at a later date? What I'd hate to have is if we passed it with saying it was complete, that would be thrown back in our face in a month or two or whenever, about, gee, it was good enough for completeness, so we don't need any more information with respect to that.
Do you want to answer that? Or?
In no way, voting something complete, does it prohibit you from requesting additional information later on. You definitely can ask for it.
Do we have any further questions of the applicant? And no further discussion, in which case, do we have a motion before us?
Madam Chairman.
Mr. Emery.
I propose the following motion. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and material submitted and the facts presented, the request of Joseph Frustacci. For minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration special permit, and a public access waiver for Ledgewood, a four-lot subdivision is deemed complete. And Planning Board public hearing is scheduled for the regular April 21st, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board.
I have a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion beyond this? All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. All those against? All those abstaining? The motion passes 4-0 with one abstention. And we will schedule a public hearing for our April 21st meeting. Mm-hmm. And a site walk prior to, oh yes, absolutely. Prior to that, do you want to check our calendars? Do you have, what's a good day, the Saturday? Those are great for me. Not this Saturday. I like Saturday. I mean, night ones, it's too dark now. But,
Saturday before that 21st is Easter Saturday, so I would suggest we
not
do
very
that.
Good.
The Saturday before that is Palm Sunday Saturday, whatever that is. The Saturday before that is April the 4th.
Does anyone have a preference? Is Palm Sunday Saturday a problem? It's not for me.
I would only suggest the earlier the better, perhaps.
Yes.
April 4th.
April 4th? I was looking to get better weather, but
well,
who knows?
Take
April
a guess.
4th
June
is fine.
June 1st is about the first day.
And then we get a black
spot. That's right.
That's it. Okay. Saturday, April 4th. Does that sound fine? Are we all right on that? Is that okay for you, Joe? Okay. What time? 9 o'clock?
That's good.
9 o'clock, Saturday morning. And where will we meet? By the pond on Woodland Road? How about right in there? Is that a good spot?
Don't park beyond the pond because I'll give you a ticket. There's no parking by the pond.
How far beyond the pond? I mean, which way? Going toward Cottage Farms? Ah, okay. Okay. Let's clear this with the police department first. Thank you. Thank you very much. And our last piece of new business in just under the wire. Scout House site plan request by Stephen Virgilio for a change of use from vacant to 1,628 square feet of retail space in the Scout House, located in the vicinity of 1231 Shore Road, for site plan completeness in accordance with Section 19-2-9 of the subdivision ordinance. Do we have the applicant for us? Do you want to use the easel? Would that be better?
My name is Beth Gould with Joy and Hamilton Architects, and I'm representing Steve Virgilio on this project.
Thank you.
The project has come before you before as the building has been vacant for, I think, almost 17 years, if I'm correct. A long time, anyways. It's been vacant. And what he's proposing to do is renovate the building and go through the channels of adding the parking to make it a retail space. I think some of the issues that were addressed before, I've tried to resolve now. I've got an amended site plan, traffic impact report,
And the water, Portland Water District letter, which I'd like to present to you.
Thank you.
Some of the items that came up for review for site plan completeness were the setbacks. The amended plan that I've given you shows the new setbacks for a building. The building existing now does have the setbacks, the location of it on the site plan. But on the new plan, I did locate where the setbacks would be if the new building was being added to the site plan. There's 50-foot setbacks on the back and the side lot, because it's above the residential district, 25 on the side and 100 in the front. That's on the amended plan that I just handed out. A stormwater report was submitted after the date to the town planner. I think you should have that. The only other item, the traffic study, I can give you a few minutes to go through that. I just call your attention to the conclusions, which are on the fifth page of the traffic study. And the traffic study is including the 12 parking spaces from Mr. Kimball's adjacent property, assuming that we are using the same driveway.
Do we have the stormwater report?
Yes.
Was it here?
Yeah, the stormwater report should have been included with the package that you received.
It has a blue cover.
It was submitted after the after the submission deadline, but before the package went out to the planning board, so it should have been attached to the package that you have.
But it's...
I can vouch for the board that we did receive it, and okay. I do have copies of it.
All right, then that's enough.
It's just two pages. The first has Tech Associates at the top.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Oh, okay. Do we have any questions or comments from the board?
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edson.
I just asked if our planner could go down through the checklist. I don't have, and I wouldn't urge the board to try to review the information that we were just given, but perhaps the applicant can advise us whether what was just given to us satisfies some of these issues. If you could go through the checklist.
Okay.
Starting only the no's in the partials, I think.
This list does come from the submission requirements in the site plan regulations in the zoning ordinance, which does, under number 7, requires that building setbacks have to be shown. It is an existing building, however, and the applicant's not proposing to make any outside construction, so the setbacks aren't going to change from what they are right now. Under 12A, there was not a stormwater report submitted in time to have comments made by the town engineer for this meeting, but a stormwater report has been submitted, and it is in your package. Under 12B, the town engineer has requested a profile and details of sewer connections, but again, these are the kind of things that he also requests prior to final approval. Under item 12C, a letter from the Portland Water District, that has just been distributed to you tonight. Under 13, a preservation plan has been is being recommended as part of the landscaping requirements. Right now, the applicant has shown trees on the plan and has indicated a desire to preserve those trees, but there is no plan right now that talks about how they are going to be preserved through any construction phase. Go right ahead.
Go ahead. There are notes on here about constructing a snow fence around the trees that they save, and that they would not park their trucks or any supplies kept under those trees. Our feeling is that we are trying to keep as much of the site the way it is as we can. We've only taken down 5 trees on the whole site, and I think the site itself is heavily wooded towards the back. And we're trying to keep that as much as we can without adding or regrading a lot of that site.
And the final item is a traffic study, which I have spoken to the traffic engineer prior to this meeting, and that study has been handed out just now. Are there any questions?
Maureen, again, in the site plan review, I'm trying to find it quickly myself. Pedestrian traffic, where would that lie?
There's a standard that talks about circulation, and there's nothing that specifically talks about pedestrian circulation, but it does talk about loading and unloading areas, parking, and also there's a section that talks about traffic circulation. It doesn't specify it has to be automobile traffic, so I think under either one of those, either under number 10 on the checklist, or there's another one a little bit further on, perhaps under sidewalk information 11D, mm-hmm. under either one of those requirements, you could look for some information about pedestrian circulation.
On the checklist, it says yes under sidewalk information.
The applicant has depicted a walkway from the parking lot to the building.
Okay. So
that information has been provided.
I guess my concern is not a complete decision.
Depending on whose definition you use.
Yes, it's definition A or B.
Do we have other comments from the board or questions?
I do have a question.
Tom Emery.
I guess we have the great fortune, and maybe it's a misfortune to the applicants, but we have the wonderful fortune to have had two people come before us with abutting properties. It's an unusual situation. And rumor has it from the Kimball application that there's an easement on this property for driveway access. I don't see that indicated on the plans. Is that a completeness issue, or have there been any discussions regarding that?
I assume that's directed towards me.
Yes, I'm sorry.
through the chair. As far as I understand, that is an easement that is under discussion between these applicants, and it's not an existing easement at this time. So one of the things we have requested from Mr. Kimball is documentation of that easement. I believe up at this time, I've been verbally assured by Beth here that they're agreeing to provide the easement, but the actual legal documentation has not been drawn up yet.
Okay. And just a minor point, there is reconfiguration of the Kimball driveway off-site on your drawing. And just to be consistent, if that requires any... I'm not sure what it's saying, but in any event, there's something going on here. Maybe that one easement will just be consistent between the two applications when you talk with Mr. Kimball. Those are my only comments.
Any additional comments from the board? Then we need a motion. I'm going to this side. I want it from there, somewhere. Yeah, I know, keep that. You're the only one that does it, right?
I did
Tom
the last
Emery.
One,
go
but
ahead.
I'll be happy to do another one. Make sure I have the right one here.
Your turn.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that, based on the plans and material submitted and the facts presented, the request of Stephen Virgilio for site plan review of the conversion of the Scout House located at 1231 Shore Road to retail use is deemed complete. A public hearing is scheduled for the regular April 21, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board.
Seconded?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. All those against? None. It passes unanimously. Okay, would we want to schedule a site walk for this property? Of course. Yes?
I'd like to now raise an issue that I raised on the other one. If I look at this lot, I wish these almost in some ways were on two different nights, because when I look at this lot and this application, this site plan looks good. Looks really, I'm not saying that everything's adequate, but it looks like what we expect. There's certainly stuff we can go forward with here, but I can't help but think that we'd all be happier. I think the applicants would be happier if we saw an innovative joint parking lot. If anyone favors that, if the applicant is willing to, at all, to explore that as a possibility, it would be nice to be able to do a joint sidewalk, but we can't do that because the last application wasn't complete. What does the board feel about that? I think it's a wonderful opportunity, and I know we can't, especially when this application looks very good. I don't feel like I would want to pressure anybody, but it's very desirable. And or one thing I might also ask, if the applicant would like to counter what I just said, is if they feel that this parking lot could easily be expanded to include parking on the other properties, and if so, then I could probably go ahead and feel good about our site walk now.
Did you want to speak, Mike?
For the board, under the site plan regulations, there's no requirement that you walk a site. So it's very open as to how you want to schedule this. Also, in previous approvals, it's not unusual for the board to walk a site very early on or to walk a site more than once. So since Mr. Kimball's application is before the board, there's nothing that says that you can't walk a site before it's deemed complete. And in fact, Mr. Kimball has expressed an interest in having the board out there as soon as possible.
Often does that not, though, get into substantive review and hence give them legal standing?
I've never heard of someone getting legal standing from a sidewalk.
Janet McKay?
I don't pretend to be an expert in this area. I suppose it's possible, and I guess if we were all aware of it, we would act accordingly, if we were all aware of the possibility that there might be something like that. I would like to see us do it together, and I don't care whether we do it earlier or do it later.
Or do it more than once.
Yes,
I agree.
Could I ask the applicant or the representative?
Why don't I ask two things? I'll ask the applicant, seeing as how this is the venue right now for this, if the applicant would mind sharing a site walk with Mr. Kimball, if he were agreeable to it.
No, not at all.
Okay, then I will ask Mr. Kimball, who is here, if he would be agreeable, even though his application is still pending completeness, if we had a joint site walk. Is that all right? Fine. Then why don't we plan a joint site walk for these two, three properties, and should we have it that same Saturday morning?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Yes.
You won't be able to? Would the applicants mind if Mr. Parkhurst went out there someday on his own and perhaps he could... If that would be okay, Steve, I just so that, you know, if you're out there prowling around, they'll know who you are. Why don't we go ahead and schedule the site walk for that same Saturday morning?
It was April the 4th.
April the 4th, and the first one was at 9, and that was a fairly large property.
Yeah, I'd say
10:30. I would say 10:30 to 11. Frankly, I prefer to go to 11 and at least have all the time I want and not feel pushed, but if the board has another feeling. Okay, why don't we do 11 o'clock Saturday morning, the 4th of April, and we'll meet in the parking lot of, where will we meet? Can we meet behind your pot, Bob, and that's a good spot back in there. Which one? The yellow house. That's what I meant. The middle house. The middle property. Right. Okay, well, I'll meet there at 11 o'clock then. And the other thing would be that we'll have a public hearing. Should we schedule a public hearing for this item?
That was part of the motion.
It was? Okay, thank you. And I guess that's it for now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other business? In which case, I would...
Ooh, I think we should have other business in the way of thanking Mr. Edsel for his long and distinguished service.
Oh, I do. Let's have a round of applause. Do I have a motion to adjourn? Seconded?
Seconded.
All those in favor? And that's unanimous.
That's it, folks.